That song, thank you so much, Sister Dean. Powerful words. I sing because I'm happy. His eyes on the sparrow, and I know he's watching me. Amen. Tonight's study is entitled Millions Fooled by a Myth. And how many of you all have your Bibles? How many of you all brought your Bibles? All right. Oh, it's perfect. That's perfect. One more light. Amen. Millions Fooled by a Myth. Very, very powerful study. But before we get into it, we want to actually always ask for God's presence to be with us in this service. So let's bow our heads. Would you bow your heads with me as a prayer? Father, we thank you so much, dear God, that you give us the privilege to study your word. But I know I can't share it without you. So I'm asking, dear God, that you would hide me behind the cross of Jesus. Touch hearts, touch minds. May these be more than just words that we hear, but may we hear the Holy Spirit as he speaks to our hearts, as he speaks to our minds, and as we hear, give us the courage to obey. We thank you, Lord. We praise your name. Forgive me for my sins, and let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable. In thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer, in Jesus' name, let everyone say, amen. And amen. It's interesting, friends, that Aristotle was one of those great philosophers. And he was such a great philosopher that whatever he said was accepted as fact. And he said a number of different things that for years people considered to be fact. And one of the things he actually he said that was considered to be fact was that spiders had six legs. But as you all can count, spiders have essentially 8 plus 2. Kind of like 10, but I guess you'd say those are kind of like antlers. But they have 8 legs, isn't that right? But for 20-some centuries, people considered spiders to have 6 legs, mainly because Aristotle said it. And most people didn't want to research for themselves to see whether or not what he was actually saying was true. Our first president, you all recall our first president, George Washington. George Washington died in the year 1799. And part of the reason he died was because mainly he had a cold, he was sick. And what they did to actually treat his sickness was this thing called bloodletting. Now, we've got those who are actually, any people in the medical field here, any medical people here. You've heard of bloodletting? Anybody heard of bloodletting? You know, actually, they just took all this blood out of him. I think they took like a, I don't know how much blood out of this guy. It's like a third, let me see, it was literally 2 quarts of blood were drawn from his veins, hoping to actually heal him from his sickness. And ultimately, he ended up dying from the bloodletting. In fact, I'll go so far as to say this, and some people may disagree, but my mom had breast cancer. And so what they did was they gave her chemo. And, you know, I know that they say that still is the best treatment, chemo and radiation. I personally believe, now some people may disagree with me, that actually she may have died more so from the chemo than the actual cancer. Because essentially while it kills the good blood cells, it also kills, while it kills the bad cells, it also kills the good cells also. So the immune system is so broken down. And I would not be surprised if we were to live 56 years from now, they would actually say it was probably one of the worst things that could have ever been done. But I'm not a doctor, so I don't know this for sure. But friends, could it be that in the religious realm, friends, there's a whole lot of things that people accept as fact, but they're not really in the Bible. And they're accepting these things based off of the traditions of the elders and those who lived long ago, as opposed to their own personal study of the Word of God. I would suggest, friends, that if we are going to be serious Christians, friends, we cannot allow anybody else's words to actually, become our ideas unless we base those words totally and completely off the Word of God. Amen? Too many people, friends, are following what their mom or their dad said or their grandmother or grandfather said. And many times, as wonderful as your parents could be wrong. Am I right? And too many people, friends, have accepted as fact things that are simply not in the Bible. And one of those things that we're going to talk about, friends, is the myth concerning which day is the Sabbath. Now, friends, we already studied this just on this past Monday night, am I right? We found out based off of the Bible, friends, that God gave us a special day called the Sabbath. And we found out, friends, that He gave us that particular day, friends, at the end of creation. Not only that, but we also found out that all throughout from Genesis to Revelation, God never changed the Sabbath. It was never changed. It was never altered. Not only that, if you read in Isaiah chapter 66, the Bible says that even when we get to heaven, the Bible says we'll actually continue to keep the Sabbath. Am I right? In fact, let's go there. Isaiah chapter 66. Get your Bible. Isaiah chapter 66, verse 20, 23 and 24. Isaiah chapter 66. If you use the Bible in the back of your pews, I'm asking you to turn with me to the book of Isaiah chapter 66. Isaiah chapter, this is page 784 if you're using the Bible in the back of your pews. Isaiah chapter 66. We're going to start with verse number 23, 24. I'm going to seek to get you out of here before 8 o'clock. Amen? Now, if I go over, bear with me, but I'm going to, by the grace of God, I'm going to try to get you out of here in good time. Amen? Isaiah 66, verse 23 and 24. Page 784, if you're using the Bible in the back of your pew. Here's what the Bible says. It says, "And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another." Actually, I tell you what, let's go back to verse 22 so you actually see the context. The Bible says this, "For as the what?" What did it say? "The new heaven. And the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, saith the Lord. So shall your seed and your name what? Okay. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one what? From one what? Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the what? Did you hear that, friends? So the Bible is clear, friends, that we are going to keep the Sabbath even when we get to heaven. So if the Sabbath has not changed, so then where in the world did this change actually come from? If the Sabbath never changed in the Word of God, then who has the right to change God's law? The Sabbath, friends, is a memorial of creation. At the end of creation week, on the seventh day God rested. And I would suggest, friends, that if people who have kept the Sabbath since the beginning of time, there probably would not be any atheist in this world. If they were to actually rest on the Sabbath and take that time out to actually commune with God and look at what God has created in nature, you could not help to believe that there really is a God, because the Bible says the heavens declare the glory of God. When we just look at nature, you cannot help but to see that there's a God on His throne. Amen? When God wrote His law at Mount Sinai, He put in the very heart of those commandments, the Sabbath commandment, the fourth commandment, connecting the commandments that deal with our relationship with God to those commandments that deal with our relationship with our brother. That one connecting commandment is the Sabbath. Something special about that particular day. One of my good friends and one of the ladies I really look up to has said that on the Sabbath, there's a glow. On the Sabbath. Concerning His commandments, God through Moses told the people that they were not to take away from them or add to them, friends. They were not to take away from or add to God's law. Deuteronomy 4 verse 2 says this, "Do not add to what I command and do not subtract from it. Did you hear the, but keep the commands of the Lord your God that I what? I give you." He said don't ever change His commandments. In fact, go with me to the book of Revelation chapter 22 just to make it a little more imprint that a little bit stronger in your minds. Revelation chapter 22. Revelation chapter 22. Very last chapter of the last book of the Bible. Revelation chapter 22. Here's what the Bible says in verse number 18. Revelation chapter 22 verse 18 and 19. Look what the Bible says here. Revelation chapter 22 verse 18 and 19. It says, "For I what? Unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the what? That are written in this book," verse 19, "and if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his what? Part out of the holy city," excuse me, "out of the book of life, and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this what?" That means, friends, that God expected for us not to actually alter or change what He wrote. Amen? Jesus Himself showed the same determination to exalt the law that He had given on Mount Sinai when He was talking to those people. And He says in these words, He says, "Do not think that I'm come to what? Destroy the law of the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to what? fulfill. Then he goes on to say this, friends. For surely I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law until how much has been fulfilled. He says, I didn't come to change it. I didn't come to alter it. It's the same as it was at the beginning. And I'm not changing. Amen?
Amen.
In fact, Jesus himself, friends, even demonstrated his example that he wanted to honor the day called the Sabbath. Here's what Jesus did. He says this. Look with me. He says, whosoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. So look what Jesus did as it relates to the Sabbath. In Luke chapter 4, look what the Bible says, Luke chapter 4. Look, this is what he did. Luke 4 verse 16. Go with me in your Bibles. I want you to see this. Just so you actually know how to get there. Let's just go there. Luke chapter 4 verse 16. And I want us to read this one together. Because people actually use those little armbands that say WWJD, don't they? You've seen people wear those WWJD bands? So let's see what Jesus did, our example. What did the Bible say about Jesus in Luke chapter 4, and verse number 16? Page 1061, if you're using the Bible in the back of your pew. Page 1061. Here's what the Bible says that Jesus did. And here's what the Bible says, verse 16. Say amen if you're there.
Amen.
And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his what? He went into the what? On the what day? And stood up for to read. So friends, for Jesus, going to the synagogue, synagogue was the Old Testament church. It was the biblical church of Christ's day. He went to the synagogue on what day? Now, was it just something he did sporadically, or was it a custom? That meant, friends, that it was something he did on a regular basis. Our example, Jesus Christ, kept which day holy?
Sabbath.
The Sabbath day, friends. He did not change and actually keep some other day holy, friends. And friends, when the religious leaders accused Jesus' disciples of violating the Sabbath, Jesus said he was the Lord of which day? Look what the Bible says in Mark chapter 2, verse 27. The Bible says, the Sabbath was made for who?
Man.
And not man for the what?
Sabbath.
Then he goes on to say, therefore the Son of Man is Lord also of what day? So, which day is the Lord's day?
The Sabbath.
Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
The Sabbath is the Lord's day, not some other day. So here is Jesus, friends. Even when he was talking to his disciples showed him the temple. You remember that? They showed him the temple, and they were so amazed at their beautiful structure, the temple, the centerpiece of the Jewish religion. And he said that that temple was going to be destroyed in about 40, he didn't say the time, but he said it's going to be destroyed to the point where not one stone will be left upon another that would not be thrown down. And this is what he expected of his disciples when they were escaping from Jerusalem before it got destroyed. He says this, pray that your flight be not in what? Winter or on the what? Which meant, friends, that 40 days after Jesus died and rose again, he was expecting for his disciples to continue to keep the what day holy? The Sabbath day holy. Because he said, pray that you don't have to run on the Sabbath day. Pray that you can rest. Pray that you can actually have some time for worship and praise on the Sabbath day. Pray that you don't actually have to run in the wintertime because it's going to be too what? Too cold. So he's expecting for his disciples and his followers to keep on keeping the Sabbath holy, friends. And when the destruction came, when the temple was destroyed, God actually blessed so these people could escape. And I believe they didn't have to actually run on the Sabbath day. Amen?
Amen.
So even if the Bible were our only source of information, we would still be able to know clearly, though, friends, what day is the Sabbath. Because some people say these things like, they're like, well, we're not for sure that Sabbath is actually on Saturday. You hear people say that?
Yes.
How do we know for sure? Well, first of all, here's how you might know for sure. The Jews have been in existence as a culture for 4,000 years. They trace themselves way back. In fact, right now, I think actually Passover just ended on like Tuesday, if I'm not mistaken. I think it was from April the 11th to the 17th. So the Jews have been keeping the same day holy for thousands of years, since God gave it at Mount Sinai. Anybody want to guess which day they keep holy? Anybody ever been to New York? Anybody ever been to New York City? Anybody ever been to New York? This is what I heard. I've never heard. I don't know for sure, but I've heard that some of the strict Jews, literally, on the Sabbath day, which is guess what day? Saturday. They will get into an elevator. Some of those who are super strict, they'll get into an elevator, and because they don't want to work on the Sabbath, they won't even touch the buttons. They'll get the people they call the goyim. Is that right? The goyim, which is another name for Gentiles, to touch the buttons to take them up to the floor where they're trying to go. Isn't that interesting? But which day do you think they keep holy? Saturday. But now let's look at the Bible, because let's even go past that. Let's look at straight at what the Bible says. You recall Jesus died. Let's look at the death of Jesus. The Bible says Luke chapter 23. Let's go to Luke chapter 23. Go with me in your Bibles. Luke chapter 23. Let's just look at this together. Luke chapter 23. We'll look at verse number 55. This is Jesus. He's about to die. Let's start with verse number 54, actually. Luke chapter 23 and verse 54. Here's what the Bible says. Jesus actually is on the cross. He's hanging between two thieves. He's breathing his last breath. And the Bible says these words. Luke 23, verse 54. Say amen if you're there. Page 1095 if you're using the Bible back of the pew. The Bible says, and that day was the what? And the Sabbath what? And the women also, which came with him from Galilee, followed after and beheld the sepulchre, and how his body was laid, and returned and prepared spices and ointments, and rested the what?
Sabbath.
According to the what? Did you hear that, friends? Let's stop there for a second. So here's the preparation, and the Sabbath is drawing nigh. Jesus is hanging on the cross, but he just about died. Now, what day do we say that Jesus died on? We call it Good what? Everybody knows that it's Good what? Good Friday. So you're telling me that the preparation day, the day of preparation, because the Sabbath was drawing nigh, is on Friday. Isn't that right?
Yes.
So then, friends, when Jesus died on that Good Friday, the Sabbath is drawing near. The women actually prepared spices and ointments, but they decided we're not going to anoint the body of Jesus because they didn't want to actually break God's what? Sabbath, because it was about to actually start. Isn't that right? So if Jesus died on a Friday, which was the preparation day, which day must be the Sabbath? Saturday has to be the what? The Sabbath day. Isn't that right? But notice what the Bible says. And we talked about this on Monday also. The women rested according to the commandment on what? On the Sabbath. But who also rested on the Sabbath? Jesus rested on the Sabbath. So even in death, Jesus kept his own commandments. Amen? Leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps. Then the Bible says on the first day of the week, let's keep going, the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, they observed the tomb and how his body was laid, rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment. Look what the Bible says in verse 1. Now on the what day of the week? Very early in the what? They and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had what? Prepared. Now I want you to get this, friends. On what day of the week did they come to the tomb? First day of the week. That's the day after the what? Sabbath. Which day is that? Sunday. We always, actually, everybody talks about early on Sunday morning. You've heard that, haven't you? Anybody been to any of those churches? Early on Sunday morning. Just about. The break of day. You've heard that, haven't you? That was on a Sunday, isn't that right? So get this, friends. Jesus rested on the Sabbath. He actually considered Sunday a work day because he what? He got up. Amen? So then, friends, Jesus, even in death, kept the Sabbath, and he made it clear in his death which day is the Sabbath, and it's what? It's Saturday. Amen? Let's keep going. So all throughout the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, there's no place where you find where the Bible says to keep any other day holy except for the what? The Sabbath day. Amen? Sunday is the first day of the week. Seventh day is the Sabbath. So here, and then in the book of Acts, all the apostles of Jesus kept the Sabbath holy. Acts chapter 13, verse 14, the Bible says they went into the synagogue on the what? Sabbath day and sat down. 13, verse 42, when the Jews were gone out of the synagogue, the Gentiles besought that these words might be preached to them the next what? Sabbath. Verse 44, the next Sabbath they came almost the whole city to hear the what? The word of God. So they were preaching on which day? The Sabbath. The Bible says in Acts 18, verse 4, he reasoned in the synagogue every what? Sabbath, and persuaded the what? Greeks and the Jews, or Jews and the Greeks. So all throughout the book of Acts, the Bible says they were continuing to keep the what? The Sabbath holy. Let's keep going. So from Genesis to Revelation, both Old and New Testament, they kept on keeping the Sabbath. So, and this is the awesome scripture. God says, I'm not changing. My covenant will I not what? break nor alter the thing which has gone out of my what? Lips. It's not going to change. If I say it one way, I'm not about to what? To change. Amen? So here's the question. If it didn't actually start in the Bible, where did it come from? Here's some quotes. Faith of our fathers, Catholic Cardinal James Gibbons. You may read the Bible from what? But you will not find a single line authorizing the sanctification of what? The scriptures. This is a Catholic speaking. The scriptures enforce the religious observance of what? Did you hear that? Let's go for it. Here's another one. Clovis G. Chapel. The reason we observe the first day instead of the seventh is based on no positive command. One will search the scriptures in what? For authority for changing from the seventh day to the what? They say it's not in the Bible. Let's keep going. So there's no biblical record. You can check all throughout the scripture. If somebody could show me a scripture which says that God has changed his holy day from Sabbath to another day, I will pay them $100 million. Let me repeat that. I will pay them $100 million. Here's another one. So let's look at the history. How did it actually get changed? Almost all churches throughout the world celebrated the sacred mysteries, the Lord's Supper, on the Sabbath of every week. Yet the Christians of Alexandria and at where? On account of some tradition, have ceased to do this. The Bible-believing Waldenses in the wilderness, they even kept the Sabbath holy. But there was a gradual change of the days. Now, this is a key point right here, the rejection of the Jews. If you read the book of Acts, you'll read about how many of the Jews were even banished from Rome because they were just causing so much of an insurrection. The Jews were hated by the Romans. They were really hated by the Romans. And sadly, Christians were many times mistook for Jews because they continued to keep the what? The Sabbath day holy. So because they were considered to be a sect of the Jews, just like they persecuted all the other Jews, they were persecuting Christians right along with the Jews. And so these Christians said, you know what? We need to actually make ourselves distinct from this other group called the Jews. We need to actually do something so they're not beating us up and killing us right along with the Jews. So they began to compromise. And one of the best ways of compromising was by keeping the same day holy that the Romans did, which was Sunday. Let's keep going. Impressive indications suggest that Sunday observance was introduced at this time in conjunction with what?
Easter.
With what?
Easter.
And then, when was Easter, by the way? When was that? It was just past Sunday, wasn't it? That's a sick move, isn't it? Let's keep going. As an attempt to clarify to the Roman authorities the Christian what?
Distinction
from Judaism. We're not Jews. We're Christians. We don't keep the Sabbath. We honor Jesus Christ and his resurrection. So we keep Sunday. In honor of his resurrection. You know, it's interesting how so many people come to church once a year. Or twice a year. Is it twice or is it once a year?
Twice.
What's the two? I know one of them is Christmas time.
And Easter.
And the other one is what?
Easter.
So it's almost like, you know, they don't need any other time of God except for Christmas and Easter, or so they think. And so, friends, here was that these Christians were in the very backyard of Rome. And because they were in the very backyard of Rome, where these people were actually worshiping the emperor, and many times on their coins, they actually considered the emperors to almost be like sun gods. So what these Christians said was, you know what? We're not going to actually worship the emperor, but we want to actually make ourselves look more palatable to these pagans. You know, it's interesting how that's what many Christians want to do. They want to make themselves more palatable to non-Christians. We need to actually make this name more palatable so that they'll accept what we actually are giving. So they actually said, you know what, why don't we just kind of actually start to keep Sunday holy as a way of actually making our faith a little more palatable to these non-Christians. And so that's what they began to do, friends, especially in Rome. And they began to compromise and keep Sunday instead of the Sabbath, friends. And gradually, and this is especially in Rome, because these were these new Christians in Rome, most of them were not Jews by birth. Most of them were what? They were Gentiles. So these Gentiles, here they are coming into this church. And they're not used to keeping the seventh-day Sabbath. They're used to actually keeping what? Sunday. Because Sunday was the day that they actually worshiped what? The pagan gods. Are you with me? So they said, you know what? So these Christians are coming into this church, and they don't have that background in Sabbath keeping. Their background is in what? Sunday keeping. So they didn't actually keep the Sabbath holy, and it didn't seem like a big deal to them like it did to these Jews. That's why you have to be careful, friends, you know, when you're actually dealing with people who've just come into the Christian faith, because many times they have a whole lot of pagan things. You know, even new Christians, many times. The Bible says if a person's a new Christians sometimes should not be put into positions of leadership, because many times they have to get all that pagan stuff that they still held on to out of their system, because otherwise they can infect the church. I hate to say it, but it's just the truth. They can infect the church with a whole lot of those things that they held when they were still in the world. They should actually continue to be taught. But in the case of Rome, there were not those many times those leaders who were Jews who could teach them, say, guess what? No, we got to keep the Sabbath holy, because this is really God's day. Let's keep going. So why Sunday, though? As I just said before, friends, the Roman government, friends, they actually worshiped their emperors, and they considered them to be like sun gods. And it was a perfect day as a way of actually reaching out to these non-Christians who kept Sunday holy. And gradually, here's what they did. They would keep Sabbath as a holy day, but they also keep Sunday as a holiday. So this is the slick move the devil was doing. What the devil did was, he made it so that Sunday was a day of feasting and partying and having fun and a joyful time, while Saturday was a day of fasting, a day of burdens, a day of sorrow. You know how it is. I know I've kept the Sabbath my entire life, but I never will forget when I was young, I could not wait until the sun went down. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Oh, man. Just 6 more minutes. Man, now I'm going to have some fun. The devil was behind that, because he wanted it to seem like the Sabbath was a burden as opposed to being a what? A blessing. When Jesus clearly said the Sabbath was made for man. And if we were to really keep the Sabbath holy, friends, we would enjoy God. In fact, the Bible says that from even to even, in Leviticus it says from even to even, you are supposed to what? Celebrate your Sabbaths. If there's a day that should be a celebration, it should be the Sabbath. But the devil, friends, has made it so it's become a what? A burden. That's what he did in those days. And he made it so that Sunday was a day of joy and laughter. That's why you see so many people, they go to Ryan's Steak, well, not Ryan's, you know, I guess we'd be going ground now. Everybody's at the restaurants, it's a party, it's a great time on what? On Sunday. Christians, and friends, it got to the point, friends, where some of these Christians actually were adamant in saying you should not keep the Sabbath. Christians were not the only ones who became careless and gradually compromised their faith. The apostolic church stood firm and pure, but when the second and third generation Christians came along, we see evidence of compromise, apostasy that started to erode the church's purity. So let's keep going. Let me keep going here. Listen to this. So then you have Constantine. And Constantine is trying to unite the empire. He's got Christians. He's got pagans. So what he says was, is I got to have some way of uniting this empire. What he does was, he passes a Sunday law. What did I say? Civil law. March 7, 321 AD. Here's what he says. On the venerable day of the sun, let the magistrates and people residing in the cities rest, and let all the workshops be what? Closed. In the country, however, persons engaged in agriculture may freely and lawfully continue their pursuits. So that's 321 AD, friends. First of all, that's actually a civil law saying that Sunday is a day of rest. But then the church caught wind of this, and the church began to follow suit. And look what the church did in 325. Sylvester, Bishop of Rome, changed the title of the first day, calling it the what?
Lord's Day.
Did you hear that? He called the first day the Lord's Day, and he says, Christians shall not what? Judaize. So now, friends, they're making it so the Sabbath is not God's day, it's the Jews' day. Did you hear that? Christians shall not Judaize and be idle on Saturday, but shall what? Work on what? That day. Now think about this, friends. This is the same day that God actually wrote with his own finger saying, you shall what? Not work. The Bishop of Rome is saying, you better work. He's saying to Christians, you better work. Contradicting what? The scriptures. Let's keep going. But the Lord's day they shall especially honor, and as being Christians shall if possible do no what? In fact, my son goes to this daycare, and I was looking, I took him there today, actually. And as I took him there today, it's got all this fencing around, praise the Lord for security. And it's a Christian daycare. It's a Christian school kind of daycare place, too. But one of the signs said, the ball field shall not be open on Sunday. So essentially, I think they're adamant and they're strict about keeping Sunday as a day of what? Rest. And you would think, oh, most people who would look at that would say, wow, these are some serious, serious, dedicated Christians who are trying to be committed in their faith. But the reality is, friends, they're not dedicated to the Bible, they're dedicated to the traditions of the what? Of the fathers. And friends, this is what happened, friends. These fathers began to pass these laws. As the prophets of Antichrist, those who maintain that work ought not to be done on the seventh day. I must have passed it. As the prophets of Antichrist, those, anyway, let me keep going. So the big thing, friends, was in the last days of Earth's history, Jesus says that people would actually, it would get to the point where they would follow tradition as opposed to the Bible. And the sad thing is that even when the Reformation came, and you had people like Martin Luther who nailed the 95 Theses on the church door at Wittenberg, and he began to actually bring the church out from under the darkness of tradition and popery, and he's actually saying we need to follow the Bible and the Bible only. Sadly, friends, even as they continue to actually seek to follow that rule of faith, there are still people who did not actually see the importance of the Sabbath. These reformers, yes, they found out some great truths.